Hello, my name is Keith Lanier from Synopsys. Welcome to our three-part video series where Samad Parekh from Synopsys and Kelly Damaru from ANSYS will show us how to design and verify state-of-the-art RFICs using the Synopsys ANSYS RF design flow. In the first module of the three-part video series, we introduced the RF design flow based on the Synopsys custom design family. We described the LNA designed using interoperable PDK from the GlobalFoundries 22FDX technology and demonstrated the synthesis of the LNA inductor layout using the ANSYS Veloci RF tool. In the second module, we will demonstrate electromagnetic modeling of the inductors in the LNA using the ANSYS Raptor X extraction engine. We will then demonstrate the RFIC simulation results analysis for this LNA using the Synopsys PrimeWave Design Environment to set up, run, and analyze results for the PrimeSim SPICE RFIC simulator. Please be sure to come back and join us for the third video of the three-part series, where we will cover custom layout solutions and demonstrate sign-off verification of the LNA, which includes EM modeling and extraction, post-layout DRC LVS validation, and post-layout RFIC simulation.
Hello, my name is Samad Parekh. I am the product manager for the analog and RF simulation solution at Synopsys.
Hello, I'm Kelly Damaru, and I'm product manager of the on-chip electromagnetic simulation portfolio of ANSYS. The LNA block that is our demo vehicle uses three inductors: the gate inductor that we synthesized previously with Veloci RF, the drain inductor, and the source inductor. The performance of the gate inductor will inevitably be impacted by the presence of the other two coils. This performance shift should be taken into account as early as possible in the design cycle with the co-extraction of all spirals together. Raptor X, the ANSYS silicon-optimized electromagnetic solver, can help you with this task. Raptor X can model any combination of passive structures, starting from inductors and going up to silicon interposers arrangements. The key point is that it is optimized for silicon, which makes it extremely fast and capable of solving huge and complex layouts. Accuracy is indisputable as a member of the ANSYS family of electromagnetic products. The electromagnetic solver for on-die applications has been certified by all major foundries and is constantly correlated with silicon measurements up to 110 gigahertz. It is the only electromagnetic solver that can model all the layout-dependent effects down to 3 nanometers and also analytically model dummy tiling of insane densities. All this can be achieved in the shortest time and lowest impact on hardware resources. And with that, let me now take you through how Raptor X can model the three inductors of the LNA block. I will set up my meshing frequency at 20 gigahertz, which sufficiently covers three harmonics for the 6 gigahertz operating frequency of the circuit. And I will run my extractions on my local machine, even though I could run on a remote grid. There are advanced settings for the meshing, and there are various layout simplifications that are applied automatically during runtime to eventually reduce design complexity and improve extraction and memory utilization. But I will not expand on all that today. Raptor X can generate S parameter files and also another format that is called rational function model, RFM. And this is particularly efficient in time domain circuit simulation. I have now configured all my settings and I'm ready to run Raptor X. I will hit extract, pick the layout I would like to fully or partially extract, and then decide how I would like to place the pins. Manually by pointing and clicking on my layout, or by using text labels that are already placed on my layout. And these would be my pins that would let me select the electrical nets that I would extract with Raptor X. Or lastly, by using previous pins that were annotated on the layout in a previous Raptor X extraction, if any. So for this particular layout, I have run Raptor X before, so I have the previous pin placement option. But for the sake of the demo, I will place pins interactively. RaptorX will allow me to exclude certain hierarchies and devices from the extraction. And this is practically a sort of black box feature. So it controls how deep in the hierarchy RaptorX will descend to pick up nets and blocks. And I will keep everything included. I will not exclude anything for this demo. And I will now click on the locations of the pins and place two pins on each one of the inductors. And I will use automatic names for them, as RaptorX offered to do. But I could also use my own names if I didn't want to do the automatic naming. And when I'm done, I will right click. And RaptorX will take me to the final stage of the extraction, where all the pins that I placed have been grouped on a per net basis. And here I can further refine the extraction settings on a per net basis. This is particularly useful in very complex cases with multiple nets. So as you can see here now, in particular for RxNet SB pin 5, I can refine the settings. And it is particularly useful in very complex cases with multiple nets because it allows you to control the complexity of the mesh on a per net basis and thus control the extraction time and hardware requirements. When I will hit finish, RaptorX will extract all the nets that I have selected and will generate a coupled model for them that will be saved in a new cell under my design library. So here, it uses the same name as my original design cell and the suffix underscore VRX. And in here, I will find all the model views registered in the design library and a symbol that I can instantiate in my circuit simulation test bench. And this symbol will easily reference any RaptorX models. So now I will hand over to Samad, who will talk about the actual circuit simulation.
Now that we've characterized the inductors, let's move on to running a small signal analysis to measure the gain and noise figure. So here I have a test bench set up for running a linear analysis. I'm going to show the analysis setup. I have set up my input and output ports, the frequency sweep, and the format in which I want this parameter file to be generated. I also have the noise checkbox checked over here because I want to make measurements for my noise figure. So let's run this noise simulation. Now that my simulation is complete, I'm going to invoke the results analyzer. Here I have a number of built-in expressions. So for instance, if I wanted to plot the maximum available gain, the maximum stable gain, S parameters, noise figure, VSWR, and so on, I can easily do that. I'm going to start with plotting the S parameter output. So I'm going to go here, specify the modifier as DB20, and select to plot S21. Here, my S21 is plotted, which gives me an indication of the gain. Let me put some cursors here, and I can see that at around 6 gigahertz, my gain is about 17.3 dB. Similarly, I can plot my S11 and S22 curves to get an idea of the input match and output match. So again, around 6 gigahertz, I see that my S11 and S22, let me expand this a little bit so we can see better. S11 and S22 are less than about negative 10 dB, which gives me a pretty decent match of these frequencies. I also want to see the noise performance of my LNA. So I'm going to select under noise here. I am going to plot the noise figure and the minimum noise figure. So let's start with the noise figure and append the minimum noise figure on the same graph. Let's put a cursor down and see what our measurements look like. Around between 6 and 7 gigahertz, we get about 0.9. It varies between 0.9 and 1.1 dB. So again, you know, it shows that, you know, we've tuned it well for our frequency of interest. You know, once we plot the noise figure, we also want to see what the noise summary looks like, because we want to see which devices are contributing the most to the noise. I'm going to go to results, print, and noise summary for that. And let's choose spot noise at 6 gigahertz and generate the noise report. Install. In the noise summary table, we can see that the most significant contributors are the input device, the different devices within that subcircuit model, and how their contributions look like to the total noise. Another very important consideration in any design is to check for the stability of that design. So next, I'm going to go back to my results analyzer. And among the many measurements that the results analyzer generates, one of them is mu1 and mu2. So I'm going to plot those as well. And I'm going to see how they look like in the graph over here. Again, if once I put a cursor down, you can see that both mu1 and mu2 are greater than zero throughout the frequency range. And within our frequency of interest, they're actually much higher, which indicates a high degree of stability for this design. Now, the next few tests that I'm going to run are going to measure the linearity of this LNA. We will start with doing a 1 dB compression point test. For this test, I'm going to sweep power at the input source, and I'm going to measure the output and see where the output power drops by 1 dB. So let's go ahead and go to a test bench for measuring our 1 dB compression point. In the schematic, this is my input source right here. I've specified a tone at a specific frequency, and I'm going to sweep this power P in. Let's go here, set up our harmonic balance simulation. Here I have my tone set up at 6.1 gigahertz. And if I scroll down, I'm going to sweep my input power, which is represented by the variable P in, from minus 70 dBm to zero in a step size of 5. So let's run this simulation. With the simulation complete, I'm going to go back to the results analyzer, look at my frequency domain harmonic balance simulation, and select gain compression. For the power, I'm going to select instance terminal, the tone at which my frequency is. And let's select the output terminal. And here I get my 1 dB compression point value as negative 12 dBm. And here I also have a plot, which plots my input power. And as you can see, it starts to drop by 1 dB at the point where it's negative 12 dBm. We will now run an IP3 test. Here we're going to specify two tones of the input port, and we will sweep their power and measure the third order intermodulation product. For this, let's go to the test bench. At the input port, we've specified two tones, the first one right here and the second one right here. And the input power again is represented by the variable Pn. My harmonic balance setup, I have the two tones specified over here, and I have my power sweep with power variable Pn specified from minus 70 dBm to zero. So let's run this simulation. Once the simulation is complete, again, I will pull up my results analyzer. and I will look at the IPN value, specified instance terminal. And I'm going to look at 10. And I'm going to look at the 2F2 minus F1. Specify my port. And I get the input referred IP3 as 1.4 dBm. Let's take a look at the waveform as well. So you can see that this is the first order, and this is the third order product. And it has a slope of 3, and they're meeting at this theoretical point, which is the IP3 point.
Thank you for watching this module of our three-part video series. To learn more about how to design and verify state-of-the-art RFICs using the Synopsys ANSYS custom design flow. For product information, please visit our links.